Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Vaishali Sood and I'm the health editor with The Quint. Tomorrow, on 16th January, India rolls out one of the biggest vaccination programs in the world. 2 crore frontline workers and healthcare workers will be vaccinated over the next 7 weeks, and the government aims to vaccinate 30 crore people by July. This is, of course, a massive landmark step in our fight against the pandemic. And you have questions, and you've sent those questions about the vaccines to us. And joining us today to help us answer those questions is Dr. Shahid Jameel. He's a virologist and he's the director of Triveni School of Biosciences at Ashoka University. Welcome, Dr. Jameel.
Thank you, Vaishali. Thank you for having me on your show.
Right. So we're going to get started right away. The first question that's come to us, Dr. Jameel, is can you explain how the two vaccines, Covishield and Covaxin, that have been approved by the government on emergency approval, how do they differ in their make?
There's a very fundamental difference between the two vaccines. Let's take the Bharat Biotech vaccine, which is called Covaxin first. This is a vaccine that is built on a very time-tested and old platform. It's essentially an inactivated viral vaccine, which means that you grow up large amounts of the virus and you use the chemical to inactivate the virus and use this whole inactivated virus or killed virus to vaccinate. This technology has been used to make many other vaccines, hepatitis A, flu vaccines. Many vaccines are in use currently using this technology. The Serum Institute or Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine is based on what we call a viral vector platform, which takes a virus, in this case, a chimpanzee adenovirus. And adenoviruses are common cold-causing viruses. The gene for the spike protein of the COVID virus is introduced into this chimpanzee adenovirus, and it is simply used as a vehicle. You can think of it as a Trojan horse to take the spike gene into our body. The spike gene will get transcribed into the right mRNA, and the mRNA will make the spike protein, and the spike protein will raise antibody responses. So they are very fundamentally different platforms. In one case, it's the full virus, COVID virus. In the other case, it's simply one gene of COVID virus taken in using a viral vector.
Right, Dr. Jameel, you know, with all vaccines, there are certain side effects that are associated with it. And it's important to tell people what those side effects are, because we're getting several such questions on what are the side effects they should be looking out for and what are the side effects they should be worried in both the vaccines.
Right. So every vaccine you take, even vaccines that have been approved, will give you some side effects. Those side effects could be something very minor, for example, redness or a soreness in your arm at the site of injection, or it could be, you know, low-grade fever for half a day or a day. It's something very common. It's actually not even called an adverse effect. It is called reactogenicity. And reactogenicity simply tells us that the vaccine has started working in your body. It is raising the kind of immune responses, attracting the right kind of cells to the site of injection, and that's why, you know, you're getting this. Vaccines are primarily tested for their safety. And we do this in multiple stages. We do it in phase one, in phase two, and then in an extended phase three. You have to realize that this is a pandemic time. Vaccines which would normally take about a year after phase three trials to get licensed are getting licensed sometimes even while phase three is running. So I would reiterate again that safety is not being compromised. What you sometimes don't know enough about is how effective a given vaccine would be. As far as side effects are concerned, these are mainly the common side effects. unless you have some serious other serious health problems and especially allergies, then you must check with your physician before you take these vaccines. And I believe the vaccine insert and the directive put out by Government of India also says this, that if you have food allergies, these emergency use approval vaccines are not yet for you. They'll get there when more safety data is available, but they're not there yet for you. But for those of us who don't have allergies, who don't have other underlying health problems, they have been proven safe to use.
Right. Dr. Jameen, what are the chances of getting Bell palsy or a seizure after getting a vaccine? This is again a concern that some people have, because there's been some reporting of it in the UK and the US.
Well, I think Bell palsy was played out to be too much. Possibly those people had some underlying neurological conditions, and it was a temporary thing that happened with one of the vaccines. I don't think it's a significant issue at all. After all, thousands of people have taken these vaccines in clinical trial mode. And if I recall, there were only four people who had these symptoms. And we don't even know whether all four of them, how many of them got the vaccine or they got the placebo. So really, there is no hard evidence that the vaccine is causing this.
Okay, so another question we have is, are there any pre-existing chronic conditions that can undermine the vaccine?
Well, if you have chronic immunodeficiency, then the vaccine will not work very well in you. And if you have immunodeficiency, then viral vector vaccine is not a good vaccine for you. Because although it is a virus that has been incapacitated to replicate in your body, but if you have some immunodeficiency, then you should not be taking a viral vectored vaccine. A killed vaccine is very safe for you to take.
So
that's the only chronic condition I can think of. I mean, in some diabetics, vaccines are not as effective as they are in people who are not diabetic. But safety is not an issue there.
Right, and just to clarify again, Covishield is a viral vector vaccine and Covaxin is an inactivated vaccine. So another question we have, heart attack patients are at high risk. Will they be getting the vaccine too? And one of the cautions that the government had issued yesterday was a person with a history of bleeding or coagulation disorders or platelet disorders should take the vaccine with caution. So if you could answer these two questions.
Well, again, you realize that both these vaccines are approved in India for emergency use, which means that initially they're going to be used in people who are at very high risk for contacting the virus, for getting the disease. And that's health workers and frontline workers. So initially, the first 3 crore people who will get this vaccine are going to be these vaccines, are going to be people who fall in that category. So even if you have a heart ailment and you're at high risk because of clotting and other issues brought on by COVID, you are not getting this vaccine now unless you are a healthcare or frontline worker. And if you are one of those people, then I think you should seriously consult with your physician before you take any of these vaccines. Any vaccine, basically in an emergency mode, if you are going to take. I'm not saying this vaccine or that vaccine, but you should check with your physician.
Right. So, another question that we have is, with the current mutations, there's a UK and there's South Africa and all of that, are there any vaccines that have been proven to be effective, or there are vaccines that are likely to be effective?
Well, let me say that they have also not been proven to be not effective. And from whatever we know, and there is actually some unpublished data that suggests that the major mutation that has happened in the UK variant will be covered very effectively by existing vaccines. So there is really no data whether some vaccine will give extra protection against the mutant. There is also no data that vaccines will not work against. I understand that there are some experiments going on both in WHO collaborating centers around the world as well as at the National Institute of Virology in Pune to address this specific question, and we hopefully will have an answer in the next few weeks.
Right. Professor, the next question I have is, what if the vaccine is only 50% effective? Will it help achieve herd immunity? Is that a concern that we should have as individuals going in for vaccines right now?
Yeah, so these are two different things, efficacy and herd immunity. They're separate, but they're also related. They are related in the sense that a vaccine with very high efficacy, let's say a vaccine that has 95% efficacy, 95% of people who get this vaccine will remain protected from disease. As opposed to a 50% effective vaccine, which will only make 50% people, protected. But, you have to realize that the end point of all trials in the world has not been infection. It has been disease. So these vaccines have been shown to be efficacious against disease, which means that you may get infected, but the virus will not replicate in your body enough to cause disease. And therefore, you will be protected from disease. That's quite all right, but that means that you can still transmit the virus. You may still make small amounts of the virus and you may shed this virus. So therefore, it is very important even for vaccinated people to wear masks in public and all that. I mean, you may be protected from disease, but you may actually be giving the virus to somebody else. And therefore, for social good, you must continue to wear masks. Now, coming to herd immunity is not a concept that can be applied at a national level or at a global level. To say that once 60% of India gets exposed to the virus, or gets the vaccine, everyone will be protected. No, that is not true. Simply because 60% of India can be achieved by, let's say, 100% vaccination of Maharashtra and 0% vaccination of Kerala. That would also achieve you 60%. But that means that while Maharashtra, everyone who lives in Maharashtra is protected, everyone who lives in Kerala will not be protected. So herd immunity is more of a local concept. It's a cluster concept. It's not a concept that can be applied to states or to the country as a whole.
So that's an important information for people to have. Another question I have, and a lot of healthcare workers have been exposed to COVID and have had COVID. So some questions that we've had is, I've already had COVID, should I still get the vaccine?
Well, my recommendation there would be, if you've already had COVID, get yourself tested for antibodies to COVID. And this is an easy test to do. All it requires is a finger prick of blood, which you can do on a rapid antibody test, costs roughly 250 rupees. If you do this test every month, you will know whether you still have antibody levels. And you should really be protected. Because remember, it's not just antibodies, it's also cell-based immunity that protects you from disease. But if you are a frontline worker and you are being given the vaccine, even if you have had COVID, I would just go ahead and take it. It won't do you any harm. It will provide you a booster effect, which will further strengthen your immune response.
Right. This is another question. How long do antibodies created by the vaccine last? Will I have to get another dose in 6 months or a year down the line?
Well, so I partly answered that in the previous question, but let me get at it again. At this time, we only have data for about 6 to 8 months because that's the only time we've had to look at recovered people. And neutralizing antibodies, which is antibodies that neutralize the virus, are shown to last for something like 4 or 5 months. But that doesn't mean that you are no longer protected. Again, you know, you may get infected, but, you know, other parts of the immunity will control disease. So it's not very clear at this point how long the efficacy of a vaccine or protection following a natural infection will last. But looking at other coronaviruses that are already endemic in our population, immunity may last between 1 to 2 years. And hopefully by that time, you know, this virus would also have become endemic and we would be out of a pandemic situation.
Right. You know, this is another question we've been getting, and a lot of regular readers also have been sending in saying that in my part of the city or in parts of Delhi and Mumbai, cases have drastically fallen. And, you know, so should I still take the vaccine? You've sort of partially answered it earlier, but if you can explain it again.
Yeah. I mean, I would say that if you are a healthcare worker or a frontline worker and you are getting the vaccine now, take it. Because you are at high risk of getting infected and you are at high risk of transmitting it to others. For the rest of us, it's really a theoretical question because, you know, if we are above 50, our turn may come sometime in April or May. And you assess at that time, and I think the government will also assess at that time, whether from a risk-benefit point of view, should people still be vaccinated in large numbers? And if you are less than 50 and perfectly healthy, have no morbidities, you'll have to wait till 2022 anyway before a vaccine is made available to you. So assess the situation, and I'm sure the government is also monitoring it, and appropriate directives will come out in time.
Right. Now, this is a question. I'm not sure if you're in a position to answer, but what will be done with medical waste like syringes, vials, needles, etc.? Because this will be such a vast rollout of vaccines. What is normally
absolutely very important question. And medical waste from vaccination has to be dealt with just like any other biomedical waste that is generated from hospitals. So it has to be collected properly, it has to be treated properly, and it has to be disposed properly. Yes, it's a major exercise, and that adds to the logistics of vaccinating so many people in such a short time. Absolutely.
Right. So this is an important thing we need to keep an eye on and think about parallelly to the vaccination drive. Now, there's another question. Can I still get COVID after taking the vaccine?
Well, COVID is a disease. It is highly unlikely that you will get disease after taking the vaccine.
Right.
What is more likely is that you will get infected by SARS coronavirus 2. And since you have taken the vaccine, the virus will not replicate very well in your body. It will not give you disease, but you may still be at a risk of transmitting it to others. And that's why I said earlier, even if you get a vaccine, continue to wear a mask till the pandemic is on.
Right. So you just answered the next question, which is, can I still transmit the virus after taking the vaccine? Yeah. So mask up, people. You need to keep yourself safe and keep other people safe as well. So the next question I'll ask you is, should a pregnant healthcare worker take the vaccine? Are there different instructions for Covishield and Covaxin?
Honestly, I'm not aware of this, so I would not really like to answer this because I may be giving you the wrong information. Please look at the relevant data and the guidelines from government.
Right, and so it's really important for you to also check with your doctors before you go ahead for these vaccinations. You answered this question as well, but I'm going to ask again for some of the viewers who are joining in late. I have food allergies to milk and eggs. Should I take the vaccine?
Well, the government directive right now for emergency use approval says that if you have any food allergies, you should not take these vaccines. So I would follow the government guideline on it.
Okay. I've heard that I won't have a choice between the two vaccines. Is that true? I think as part of most government rollouts world over, if I'm not mistaken, Professor, there are no choices being given right now.
Yeah, right now vaccines are available in limited quantities, so there isn't a choice. And I think just this morning somebody sent me the government order on this. And the way it's likely to happen is that healthcare workers will be provided information on both vaccines. They will have to sign a consent before they go in for vaccination. But once they are in the vaccination booth, they will not know which vaccine they are getting.
Okay.
I think that's the protocol that the government is planning to follow.
So I just want to ask a parallel question along those lines. You know, if I get a Covishield for the first time, I should get the same vaccine the next for my second dose? Is that important?
Absolutely, absolutely. You cannot mix and match. If you mix and match, it probably is not going to cause you any harm, but it won't cause you any good either. The idea is that the first dose of vaccine primes your immune system, and the second dose boosts the immunity that you get to make it more long-lasting. So if you take one vaccine as the prime and second vaccine as the boost, then the boost is actually not a boost. It's another prime, and therefore your immunity is not going to be very effective or long lasting.
But this is an option that's being actively explored in the UK and US, if I'm not mistaken. But I mean, for now, what I do know is that the government of India is saying you'll get the same vaccine as the second dose.
I don't think that's the case. What they are exploring is whether the second dose can be given a little later than what was planned, than what was tested in phase three. And that's okay because, you know, the window period for boosting is a bit longer than 4 weeks. On the other hand, we must understand that unless we get both doses, we are not fully protected.
Right.
So it's not that you take one dose and you think that you are protected.
So my next question is it mandatory to take vaccines? Can I just say no? Again, this is, I guess it's an option that you always have. So we can skip that question. I'll ask you.
No, so let me just answer that. I think the government has made it very clear that people will have an option to say no. You will have to opt in.
Right.
So it's your choice. If you don't want to take a vaccine, nobody's forcing you to take a vaccine.
Right. Finally, when will 20-somethings with no comorbidities like me get the vaccine? I think, should they be concerned? The young people were.
You're lucky to be 20-something with no comorbidities. You know, cherish that. Take care of your health. You know, eat well and stay healthy. And, you know, by the time your time comes to take a vaccine, we may not even need a vaccine.
Right.
That would be the good thing.
Yeah, exactly. And I just want to ask one last question. You know, currently, India is seeing like this ebbing of the cases where we have about very few cases being reported pretty much every day compared to Europe and the US, where the situation is much different. And a lot of people are asking, you know, now that India seems to have the situation under control, do we really need to get vaccinated? Can you explain that? You know, no low numbers doesn't mean end of pandemic. You can just talk to people a little bit about
no,
that.
No, absolutely. The pandemic hasn't ended. We may have low numbers today, but that's no guarantee that there would not be the so-called second wave in the next few months. And, you know, the fact is that vaccines have been developed in record time in a pandemic situation. a vaccine is no good if it sits in a refrigerator. A vaccine is good only when it gets into your arm. So as long as vaccines have been proven to be safe, which I think all vaccines have been proven to be safe, and you know, they have been proven to be effective, although the efficacy differs from one vaccine to the other, it would be prudent to get vaccinated. You know, vaccines are one of the most economic public health tools. For every dollar that you spend on a vaccine, the return you get is $44 in terms of children who grow up to be healthy adults. There is no other investment that you can make that gives you such high return. Through all this debate, through all this uncertainty, through all this communication gap and all this concern, let us understand that vaccines are very good public health tools, and nothing we should say or do should undermine that.
Right. That's a really good point and an important point to end on, Dr. Jameel. And another point that you've made earlier, I'm going to reiterate that, mask up. You know, even after getting a vaccine, take all precautions that you can, and for yourself and for your loved ones, because there's a large part of the country that will take a long time to catch up with the vaccines. So thank you so much again for joining us. It's always a pleasure talking to you, Dr. Jameel, and thank you for taking time and answering all these questions.
Thank you, Vaishali. Thank you very much.
Thank you.